Okay, thank you very much. Well, it is great. It is great thanks to the organizers, although I am among them. But nevertheless, of course, I participated very in Epsilon. At the same time, it's been enormous efforts to make it possible. So also probably we have to thank the administration of earlier institute and by me for, I believe that our conference, our program now, it is the first one which running first. And Yelena gave last week the first post-pandemic talk. Yes, so this method. So this is what I'm going to talk about. And I'm going to talk about to take a cylindrical KDV. So this cylindrical, just lazy to write long words, as a case study. So if we have PD, well, it's always going to be 1 plus 1. So I'm going to 1 time 1x. So this is basically where the integrable systems live. So if we have evolutionary PDE, so then of course the key issue of the theory of its solution is the global properties of solution. So long time asymptotics, developing of singularity, so all this is what we are mostly interested about. If the equation is linear, then there is of course very powerful method, so Fourier. Fourier method. Well, it is of course makes produces the explicit integral solution for the situation when the constant coefficients. But even for non-constant coefficients, it is still very great tool. Most oftenly produces the contour integral presentation. So this is a main thing about linear equations. So if it is nonlinear, then, well, if it is genuine nonlinear, there is no kind of general method. So that's what something like Fourier. Integrable in the sense of lux pair integrable, then there is instead of Fourier, there is a kind of the nonlinear analog. It is inverse scattering transform, which produces Riemann representation. Of U. Which produces Riemann-Hilbert representation of U. And this is what I'm going to talk about. Nowadays, I believe it is, and especially in such audience, it is already, I just remind, so it means that my equation can be written as a compatibility condition, as a operators. More generally, it is some matrix version of this. It is a zero curvature equation. It is something like this. When U and V are matrices depending on lambda, on spectral parameter, this in turn allows indeed to write this Riemann-Hilbert representation. So, to have integral representation is very good because we can apply asymptotics of the Riemann-Hilbert oscillatory problem. This is a contour integral, oscillatory type of contour integral. This is oscillatory type of Riemann-Hilbert problem. And there are basically two approaches to asymptotic analysis of this problem. The first one, it is an asymptotic solution of the direct scattering problem. So we assume something about solution and solve even formally the direct spectral direct scattering problem, and then cook from this solution asymptotic solution of Riemann-Hilbert. Was the more original approach was introduced by Monakov and Zakharov in 1978, I believe. So then it was well developed by Sukhanov, Boguslav, Sukhanov, and Independent Shenov. And in 92, it was exact analog of the steepest descent. So it is nonlinear steepest descent. It is asymptotic solution of the inverse scattering problem. Introducing this version, it is very powerful also in the sense of spreading to other areas. So for instance, originally it was introduced to linear integrable PDEs, but now it is applied also for orthogonal polynomials, random matrices, random processes, Toeplis determinants, statistical mechanical smooth. Asymptotic solution of this problem proved to be allows to spread integrable techniques on other areas. Okay. Very well. So the most important features of the method: cylindrical KdV, which is the following equation. 6 VVX. Other case, so I will also assume that, of course, we have to put initial data not at zero but at point, and it is Schwarz class. This is the integrable system equation. So Lux pair is produced by the following operators V minus x 60. So this is a star operator, and a is minus 4 minus 6 v dx.
V is
dependent on infinity,
right?
Yes. So this initial data.
Not
yet. So I will mention. I will. Okay. So this is this. Okay. Maybe it's better to write it. Of course, if we just make the change. V minus x 60. Point is that you also, in a sense, I could have called my talk just KdV, but in the class of increasing initial data. So this hasn't been considered also. Okay, so there is this, if somebody never did it, it is a equivalent to this equation. So V dot and some extra terms. And then when you calculate this commutator, all differentiation disappear in you only scalar functions. And only scalar functions. Why I took this as a case study? For two reasons. The application nonlinear steepest descent, it is somewhat easier than for the standard KdV. Somewhat easier. At the same time, it has some new features, which are absent in the standard situation. So in a sense, this is also, of course, equation reference to the This it appears in description of cylindrical rotation plasma, acoustics wave in the cylindrical rotation plasma. And it's integrable.
So you mean it has natural physical
applications? Yeah. So that is important, that all those classical integrable system, KdV nonlinear Schrödinger equation, they appeared not as an examples of like spheres, they appeared originally in applications.
Yeah, sure.
So that is also good. If some students appear, it would be maybe good to bring attention to some open problems to that, because you see the standard KdV in a sense. The first flaw of the analysis is already more or less cleaned. So now there are, of course, very interesting open problems. Going to remind or introduce basic ingredient Hilbert method. I'm just describing Riemann-Hilbert problems. It is a pair of oriented contour gamma and the function. Contour gamma actually might be, so this is the simplest, most situation, but it is quite possible to have self-intersection. And several components, all these are admissible contours. It is a map. It is usually defined only on gamma to GL, well, and C. Yeah. It can be. So there are some. So the contours should not have tangential, they should, the intersection should be trans, okay. Okay, so this is, so n is cosine greater than, that in particular the periodic problem, well, again, periodic problem was considered by Matvey. There are old papers, okay, but having this gamma g to find n by n function such that it is holomorphic c minus gamma. It has plus minus values on gamma. So to get y, this is a lambda. To get y plus, I have to take lambda tilde. Normalization. Some sort, not necessarily, but usually it is normalization by identity at infinity. Of course, it is very formal. So, plus to the left. So this is a, yeah. So of course it is very, very formal. So in each, so there are two ways how to make it looks rigorous. So first, it is what we do. So we use this problem as a tool. This is what the we every time we have some concrete data, concrete matrices, concrete contour, we have to, in each concrete situation, we explain what does all this mean, in which sense. In which sense the limits are taken, in which sense this is taking. So this is what one way to look at it rigorously. But this, of course, has been for many, many years, can be a weakest setting is LP setting. But we are not going to consider all this. I have, so this is, of course, Ilya Spitkovsky about triggers. Again, when I come to the concrete, my concrete example of KDV, then I will formulate everything in the view. But now let us assume that that we have everything. So I'm going now to discuss some general facts. The problem, and I'm going to assume that always needed analytics to present those facts are very simple from the again formal point of view fact about this Riemann-Hilbert problem is uniqueness. Uniqueness of solution. Again, if we allow ourselves do what I am going to do now, then it is immediate property for the same G, the same gamma, I have another Y tilde function which satisfies. It is safe to take inverse because is from GL. And so if I in fact we even if n is greater than 1, which is always which is our interesting thing, then I would always it is always can be made G belonging to SL. So determinant it is always of this relation. I would get so for the determinant, there is no jump. At infinity, determinant goes to 1. Determinant is, so of course it is still analytic because I can inverse on C. But what about its jumps? It is y tilde plus. Of course, it is y tilde minus g and y minus g. So I use cos g cancel. Usual complex analysis theorems conditions, we would have that X is analytic everywhere, and moreover, it approaches identity at infinity. No, so it is identity. So X is identity. So this is uniqueness. So it is very simple fact if we, of course, have all the necessary analytical environment for this problem. Okay. Very good. Second thing which I am going to use. Okay, uniqueness. I probably even erase it. So the second thing, it is Plimel or cannot remember. So this Plimel-Sakhotsky formula. So of course it is very fundamental and classically, I'm just remind properties of, oh no, y. This is, I use y. So this is a well-known properties of this Cauchy integral. So there are different functional classes assumptions. But the standard, what we absolutely enough for us, it is gamma smooth It might be closed or might be not closed. It might have smooth up to the end points. And G Hölder. Hölder class. Then, of course, very well known classical.
Piecewise
differentiable. Huh? Piecewise differentiable. Probably. No, smooth. Yeah. Piecewise smooth. But actually, it is either completely closed and smooth, or it has endpoints. So in this sense, something like this is also, it is just the situation of, you know, you have corner points.
What does mean smooth?
No, smooth means C infinity, so everywhere,
It depends on lecture.
Yeah, smooth C infinity. C infinity, it is always well, again, it is not very necessary, but yeah it
but
is.
Why C1 would not be sufficient?
Huh?
Why C1 would not be sufficient?
No, I think it would. But I'm just jumping.
I see.
So because again, you see, it is formulas which I after. It is not the. So what I'm after it is that these properties that y of lambda is of course analytic outside of gamma, and there are. And it is, there are plus minus, which is plus minus 1/2 g of lambda plus 1 over 2 pi I gamma g of lambda prime minus lambda d lambda prime. If lambda is inside, so somewhere here. And what, in which sense y plus minus? In the sense of just continuous. So in fact, it means that not only y of lambda is analytic outside of gamma, which is trivial, kind of, but also if I take any point strictly inside of gamma when it is smooth, or maybe C1, and take some small, then I would have, say, omega plus, omega minus. Then this integral is continuous in the closure of here, and continuous in the closure if the restrictions on omega plus is continuous on the closure of omega plus, and its restriction on omega minus is continuous. So there is no question about in which sense I take y plus minus, so they exist in the uniform sense. And we have this formula. And from this formula, the most important thing which I need from this formula is of course this relation. Y plus of lambda minus y minus of lambda is g of lambda. So this is the probably number one fact which is used in the theory, in the method of the, so this is formula. So again, it is, I'm after this formula and not as much. Of course, everybody knows, and some knows even more about this than I do. And of course, there are this extension for L2, LP, on all this very delicate relations. But for us, of course, in applications, very often what we actually have, we have. Look, come on in. actually G. Actually, this density is even analytic, analytic in some neighborhood of gamma. And if it is analytic in some neighborhood of gamma, you can immediately, of course, prove this in two, three lines. Just to get plus, you take this gamma and make room for lambda tilde to just to take lambda in the usual way, and then everything is of course becomes in two lines. Okay, but what is great about this relation? Of course, from this it follows the following important fact. So if the my Riemann-Hilbert problem, yes, if it is commutative, it means that if this is commute for different lambda, I can immediately produce a formula, explicit formula for its solution. So of course it is in particular, it is for just n equals one when I have the scalar. Yes. So it is basic examples of this, it is n equals one or g of lambda triangular. So this is two basic examples, g of lambda triangular. Because if I have this, I can take logarithm. I can take logarithm. I can take logarithm of lambda. And now I can use this formula. Now I can use this formula. So it means I get the following explicit expression for solution. Многомерный. It is, it is general. So whatever, if I have commutativity. Of course. Not yet. So of course, where should I take some room? Let me continue here. No, yes, no, I think that the important thing that I can, that but they should commute for different lambdas. So then you can take logarithm. No, So this is actually, this my triangle, it might be this identity, might be a matrix, identity matrix, so it might be huge, but it's still commute for different lambda. Of course, there is an issue. When I write this formula, when I take logarithm, I would have to, and if contour gamma is closed, then there is an issue about index. So suppose I have just a scalar case, then it would be, but nevertheless, this is a good start formula. So you have to modify it, you have to correct it to take care of the indices. So if there is a, so in n equals one, it is the issue in n equals one. Because there is no now, you remember when I proved uniqueness of the solution, I assume that G is SL. And this is of course good for, it is non-trivial for n greater than one. And if n equals one, assuming that G is one, is not interesting. So, and then there might be indices, there might be a non-singular solution. No, this is linear algebra. So it is it is a. So when you can have, when you have this formula.
Okay, it's okay. It's okay. But how? Why commutativity of G at lambda prime is important to take the logarithm?
This is for instance. Then otherwise you would not be able to take logarithm integral. But then, and all. I understand what you mean. So, okay. Okay. Yeah. It's probably just a second. Mm-hmm. Logarithm. No. Okay. Let's do it in this way. The other way around. If I have, okay, so suppose I have this, then I can write that. Then there is no ambiguity in writing this formula, because then I would not be, it would not be needed to take some, you know, chronicle. yeah. So then it is fine. So then this formula is okay. Yeah. And then I begin just to check that I solve this problem directly using again this. Yeah. So it's the other way around. So if you are, but probably there is a way to somehow to also to kind of assume that y of lambda also commute what again, so in particular, so probably this my second example would be absolutely comfortable to discuss. The triangular? No. No, why? It is, нет, я думаю, что есть. Я так как-то так небольшой специалист и на алгебре, но я думаю, что есть, так сказать. Не обязательно троян. So it is, it does not follow that if I have this, then G of lambda of this type. No. But of course, if it is, it is. And moreover, if indeed I take G of lambda of this, if I take G of lambda of this, then of course, we have to make, okay, so it should be break. Yes, so, okay, let me just finish with considering this. If I take this, then I, just to solve the problem, I can look for y of lambda because the solution is unique. So I can look for y of lambda from the same subalgebra as 1, y of lambda 0, 1. And then, of course, y plus equals y minus g just becomes y plus in terms of y, it just becomes this. Of course. So kind of the addition becomes multiplication if you consider triangular matrices and vice versa. And of course the answer would be for the solution, there is no problem with the indices, with anything. Would be just this. So this is a kind of the simple but important case of kind of explicit solvability. Of course, again, I skip discussion if I have corners, if I have endpoints. There is, of course, this integral would behave as have logarithmic singularity of those corners, and I would have to make some arrangements to guarantee uniqueness, some arrangements, some additional conditional behavior of the solution in these corners. But again, when we have a concrete situation, We will do it. And by the way, it is a simple exercise. It is a very simple exercise on linear algebra to see that if I take G like this, then this formula becomes this one. If you carefully calculate all the logarithms of the triangular matrices, then of course you would arrive to this formula.